Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents New York Jew by Alfred Kazin, narrated by Stephen J. Cohen. Chapter 1. Words. Anything can happen now that we've slid over this bridge, I thought. Anything at all. The Great Gatsby. One dreamlike week in 1942, I published my first book on native grounds, became an editor of the New Republic, and with my wife Natasha, moved into a little apartment on 24th Street in Lexington. Its casement windows looked out on a shop that sold everything you could possibly need for your horse. From across the street, the shop seemed to gleam with silver rein buckles, brightly polished saddles and bridles. In front of the shop stood a prancing, thoroughly affable wooden horse, painted bright yellow. I had never lived in Manhattan before. In those first few weeks of my arrival in the big city, I went between my home, my publishers at Lexington and 28th, and the New Republic at 49th and Madison, in a dizzy exultation mixed with the direst suspicion of what might happen next. Riding away from the office at the violet hour in the sudden opulence of wartime, when the incomparable autumn light of New York still hung over the buildings that would soon be shadowed by the faint wartime brownout, I could feel when the taxi skidded around the circular passageway under the ramp of Grand Central into Fourth Avenue, sensations of personal deliverance that came and went like the light between the arches. I was stupefied by the advance interest in my book, which would soon give me a considerable boost at the New Republic. I loved working in the center of New York and living in Manhattan. Riding home at the rush hour, I could taste all the wild distraction of New York in wartime, like a first martini. But I missed my long, solitary days in the 42nd Street Library. I was expecting at every moment to be called into the army, and I was not prepared for so much good fortune. I had begun my book in our single room in Brooklyn Heights, soon after our wedding at City Hall. It was 1938. We were 23. We had known each other 2 weeks. Natasha was taking her doctorate in bacteriology at Bellevue, and we were both in a terrible rush to get away from everything we had grown up with. Beginning my book in a mood of great husbandly contentment, I soon knew that thanks to an idle suggestion from Carl Van Doren, who liked my first reviews and literary essays, I had found my natural subject. Van Doren wondered why there had never been a study of the new American writing in the 20th century that would also be a historical explanation of its emergence. For almost 5 years, I had worked toward the book in the great open reading room, 315, of the New York Public Library, often in great all-day bouts of reading that began when the place opened at 9 in the morning and that ended only at 10 at night, with my friend Richard Hofstadter, who was writing Social Darwinism in American Thought for his doctorate at Columbia. I would snatch my lunch in the automat across the street from the library, run up Fifth Avenue in the brownout for exercise, find a pool parlor off Times Square for a hurried game of ping pong, then return to the great yellow tables in 315, somehow always smelling of fresh varnish and piled with our books, on which we had left little notes saying back soon, do not disturb. We spent an afternoon every week in the Translux Newsreel Theater on Broadway and solemnly congratulated each other the day we were privileged to look at lines of heavy tanks lumbering off the Detroit assembly lines like new automobiles. War, blessed war, had come to the rescue of my generation. and nothing would ever be the same. I had written my book at the kitchen table in Brooklyn Heights, on 41st Street near the L in Long Island City, at Provincetown in the summer of 1940, and the last summer at Yonto in Saratoga, where, as I saw Natasha walking way down Union Avenue to her train, I was blinded by my tears and the grief that was to come. For almost 5 years, I had lived in a state of scholarly innocence, of unexpected intellectual assurance that floated my book home on the radical confidence of the 1930s. I had gone back and forth between the subway and 315, between Bryant Park and 315, between the Automat's coffee spigot and 315. Between Natasha's influenza lab at Bellevue and 315. There it was. As soon as you walked up the great marble steps off Fifth Avenue, on the diffusion of education among the people rest the preservation and perpetuation of our free institutions. It said that to you as you enter the great hall, in gold letters, on the pylons facing the Fifth Avenue entrance. The entrance also read, "The library is open every day of the year, 9 a.m. through 10 p.m., Monday through Saturday, 1 to 10, Sunday." Year after year, I seemed to have nothing more delightful to do than to sit much of the day and many an evening at one of those great golden tables, acquainting myself with every side of my subject. Whenever I was free to read, the great library seemed free to receive me. Anything I had heard of and wanted to see, the blessed place owned first editions of American novels out of those germinal decades after the Civil War that led to my theme of the modern. Old catalogs from long-departed Chicago publishers who had been young men in the 1890s, trying to support a little realism. Yellowing, crumbling, but intact sets of the old masses, 1911 through 1918, which was to the Stalinist new masses what St. Francis is to the Inquisition. The old delineator, under the brief editorship of the disgraceful failed novelist Theodore Dreiser, which cravenly opposed the vile sexual immorality that had wrecked Sister Carrie. The smart set, which was not for the boneheads, said Mencken and Nathan when they took it over in 1914. The chapbook, which was published in Chicago in the yellow 90s, yellow especially in Chicago, and whose honesty about the local scene explained why so many strong novels would soon come out of Chicago. Forgotten pamphlets by genteel lady hacks of 1900, still attacking Henry James for his un-American immorality in permitting a splendid American type like Daisy Miller to walk in the Coliseum at night with a greaser. Every possible item bearing on Randolph Bourne, Eugene Victor Debs, Max Eastman, Art Young, and the many other socialists and writers collared by the government for opposing what Dos Passos would call Mr. Wilson's War. The endless medical advice by Upton Sinclair on how rice cured his headaches, and on how to avoid the death by drink suffered by armies of American writers. The opinions on practically everything by James Huneker, Henry Mencken, Willard Huntington Wright, Irving Babbitt, Paul Elmer Moore, Edmund Wilson, R.P. Blackmer, Alan Tate, their followers, and their followers' followers. So between 1938 and 1942, I would, many a morning and evening, make my way across Fifth Avenue to the main door, under the inscription, "But above all things, truth beareth away the victory," past the great hall with its tantalizing display of Renaissance maps, incunabula, letters by Dickens, and, since I was too intent on 3:15 to wait for the elevator, would dash up those steps whose exhilaratingly smooth marble was so much a part of the lordly building designed in 1898 by Carrere and Hastings, past the enormous wall painting, blind Milton dictating Paradise Lost to his daughters, through the third-floor halls lined with the many prints of old New York fires and firemen collected by Isaac Newton Phelps Stokes for his iconography of New York City, and finally arrive at the great catalog room lined wall-to-wall with trays of endlessly thumbed cards. I was my own staff researcher, a totally unaffiliated freelance and occasional evening college instructor who was educating himself in the mind of modern America by writing. In the middle of the Great Depression, a wildly ambitious literary and intellectual history. 3:15 was my intellectual armory. My privacy was complete. No one behind the information desk ever asked me why I needed to look at the yellowing, crumbling, fast-fading material about insurgent young Chicago and San Francisco publishing houses in 1897. No one suggested that I might manage whatever it was I was doing with something more readily available than the very first issue of Poetry in 1912, The New Republic in 1914, muckraking Collier's in the Theodore Roosevelt era, material showing President Nicholas Murray Butler's displeasure with Professor Charles A. Beard's An Economic Interpretation of the Constitution of the United States. Professor Beard's resignation from Columbia, when President Butler sharply discouraged objections to Mr. Wilson's war. The attacks of John S. Sumner's Anti-Vice League on Theodore Dreiser's The Genius. Alfred A. Knopf persuading cowardly booksellers to show the new American and European novelists he was publishing. Eugene O'Neill's experiences living a season on the Provincetown Dunes near the old Peaked Hill Bar Coast Guard Station facing the Atlantic. As one of the people in the New York Public Library, I could get the story of Mrs. Frank Doubleday getting Mr. Frank Doubleday to suppress Doubleday, Page and Company's edition of Sister Carrie. Frank Norris's efforts as an editor at Doubleday to sneak out review copies of that wicked book. The 1918 propaganda by literary people that H.L. Mencken was pro-German, attacks so personal that by 1940 Mencken was defending Hitler. The founding of new magazines, publishing houses, experimental theaters by new people who were radicals, sexual, and political, even in the ivy-dead American universities. I came to know what Edmund Wilson thought of his classmate Scott Fitzgerald when they were both at Princeton, and how that dogged libertarian John Dos Passos was so horrified by the communist execution of anarchists and socialists during the Spanish Civil War and his friend Hemingway's indifference to these murders that Dos Passos turned sharp right. "There's my Middle West," Fitzgerald crooned in the last slow movement of The Great Gatsby. Years before I saw Chicago, I learned what hope, elan, intellectual freshness came with those pioneer realists out of the Middle West who said there was no American literature but the one they were rushing to create. My subject had to do with the modern as democracy, with America itself as the modern, with the end of the 19th century as the Great Preparation. In lonely small towns, prairie villages, isolated colleges, dusty law offices, national magazines, and provincial academies, where no one suspected that the obedient-looking young reporters, law clerks, librarians, teachers, would turn out to be Willa Cather, Robert Frost, Sinclair Lewis, Wallace Stevens, Marianne Moore. The new literature was being created inside an old century, proud, stormy, yet elegant. The elegance was still in those great halls of the library, up those marble stairs, always surrounded by pictures of the mid-century reservoir that had been replaced by the library. The old firefighters in their red wagons. The traditional view from the battery. These put me right back into the turn of the century that saw the building of the library and the intellectual insurgence and radical hope that bedrocked my book. Even the spacious twin reading rooms, each two blocks long, gave me a sense of the powerful amenity that I craved for my own life. A world of power in which my own people had moved about as strangers. It fascinated me in those days of our easy radicalism before the war, and only the war, ended the Great Depression. To do my reading and thinking in that asylum and church of the unemployed, of crazy ideologists and equally crazy Bible students doggedly writing "you lie" in the reference books on the open shelves, of puzzle fans searching every encyclopedia, of commission salesmen secretly tearing address lists out of city directories. Whatever happened to the little man with one slice of hair across his bald head, like General MacArthur's, the little man who was always there every day I ever went in between 1938 and 1942, poring with a faint smile over a large six-column Bible in Hebrew, Greek, Latin, English, French, German. Or the bony, ugly, screeching madwoman who reminded me of Maxim Gorky's Boles. The anguished old maid who had a professional scribe take down passionate letters to a lover and then ask the scribe to make up letters from the lover to her. She invariably accused the man reading next to her of trying to pick her up. She would cry out with a madly content smile, "This is a library, Buster, a place to read in. Get it, Buster?" Street philosophers, fanatics, advertising agents, the homeless, passing faces in the crowd. I liked reading and working out my ideas in the midst of that endless crowd, walking in and out of 315, looking for something. That depression crowd, so pent up, searching for puzzle contests, beauty contests, clues to buried treasure off Sandy Hook, seeking lost and dead rich relatives in old New York books of genealogy and Pittsburgh telephone books. Reading in the midst of this jumpy depression crowd, I too was seeking fame and fortune by sitting at the end of a long golden table next to the sets of American authors on the open shelves. I could feel on my skin the worry of all those people. I could hear, day and evening, those relentless, hungry footsteps. I was entangled in the hunger of all those aimless, bewildered, panicky seekers for opportunity. I must have looked as mad to them as they did to me, jumping up with excitement and walking about the great halls as I discovered that just for the asking I could obtain all the books anyone would ever want to read by William Dean Howells, Henry James, Stephen Crane, Joseph Kirkland, Robert Herrick, Ed Howe, Henry Blake Fuller, Frank Norris, Theodore Dreiser, Jack London. I could read the mind behind each book. I felt connected with the text. There was some telepathy working between me and the invisible person, the omnipresent mind that had put down these words. I was hungry for it all the time. I was made so restless by the many minds within my reach that no matter how often I rushed across to the automat for another bun and coffee to fuel up at those stand-up tables for New Yorkers too harried to eat their food sitting down, I could never get back to my books and notes. Back soon. Do not disturb. Without the same hunger pains tearing me inside. There was something about the vibrating empty rooms early in the morning, light falling through the great tall windows, the sun burning the smooth tops of the golden tables as if they had been freshly painted. That made me restless with the need to grab up every book, press into every single mind right there on the open shelves. My book was building itself. The age was with me. On the diffusion of education among the people rests the preservation and perpetuation of our free institutions. I was one of the people. I wanted to get at the historical skeleton beneath the flesh. I was fascinated by the seed time of modern America in the turn-of-the-century books I was always reading. Behind the structure I was building up was the picture in my mind of a blazing, hot summer's day. Immigrants are getting out of steerage onto the pierhead in New York. It is 1891 or so, one of those great dark years instilled in me before I was born. A woman in a street-sweeping tight skirt, wearing a blouse with Lego mutton sleeves, is walking slowly with the practiced anguish of the Russian Jews between the ship and her temporary American nest on Rivington Street. She has discovered that she is great with child and is talking without love to my grandfather Abraham, Abraham the first believer. Abraham, the patriarch, I shall never see. He is a frightened young social democrat of 22 in a derby and a ridiculous high collar who is already possessed of a wife and of a son who will be my father. My grandmother, in the blouse with Lego mutton sleeves, is by no means pleased, is indeed frightened, to arrive pregnant on this unknown shore. The strangest thing about Grandfather Abraham, this patriarch, is how young he seems to me as I see him wandering about the Lower East Side, with the portable sewing machine on his shoulder. There is a cheerful letter in the famous column of the Jewish Daily Forward, which is a socialist paper and carries on its masthead, "The workers have nothing to lose but their chains. They have a world to win. Workers of the world, unite." The letter reads, "My heart bounded with joy when I saw New York in the distance. It was like coming to the world city where everything breathed in freedom and where I can become a proletarian." But the real word to the worldly wise in America is, do not take a moment's rest, run, do work, and keep your own good in mind. And this must be my grandfather's word to himself, though he is a socialist. You rent a machine by the day from one boss thief. You work it by the day for another boss thief, and it is all piecework, paid by the piece. You start so early in the morning and end up so late at night that the Orthodox in the shop stop three times in the day for prayer. In the one torn, smudged, broken little photograph I have of my 22-year-old patriarch Abraham, he is beardless. No doubt, during the prayers, he waited patiently out of respect and did not work. Immigrant Jews, even the boss, all are brethren. Chavarim, children of one historic experience. It is possible that my socialist grandfather, who of course knows his prayers and will teach them to my father, will as a matter of course join the other peace workers when they cry out, as they put on their prayer shawls, How godly are your tents, O Jacob, your habitations, O Israel. How young he looks to me. How puzzled, crammed and laden with burdens. I must save him. It is all up to me. It will always be up to me. The Jews are my unconscious. In Russia, the great Pobedonostev, head of the Russian Synod and friend to Dostoevsky, disposed of the noxious Russian Jews in one sentence. One third will die, one third will leave the country, and the last third will be completely assimilated within the Russian people. But if Russia segregated and tortured the proscribed Jews, America gives some arrivals little joy. Already a father, and with another child on the way, my patriarch takes it into his head to organize miserable peace workers by himself. I can just hear my pregnant, certainly more practical grandmother telling him off. He works harder, harder. He is tearing at my heart. Those first lockouts and picket lines in winter will kill him yet. I see him forever trudging about, pack on back, pack and back, like those Jew peddlers you can still see in New York pushing a cart full of secondhand clothes and ringing a bell. I cash old clothes. I cash old clothes. I would like to save him. He is so young and looks so baffled and walled in by this strange land. He dies, 25, maybe 26. His body is flung in with thousands of other immigrant Jews who perished those first years on the East Side. My father will never be able to find his father's grave. The terrified widow gives birth to a posthumous child who is, of course, named Abraham after his dead father. Alone now, with her two sons in oceanic New York, my grandmother somehow makes her way back to Minsk, puts my father into the orphan asylum, finds work as a maid, then marrying again and starting a new family seems not to have had much contact with my father. He wound up in one of the agricultural schools set up by the philanthropist Baron de Hirsch to put young Jews on the land. Then came to America on his own when he was 19. My uncle Abraham will never be able to prove that he was born here. My grandmother must have left in a terrible hurry. My father will never get over the shock of his father's death, the sudden return to Russia, the orphan asylum, and the long absence from his mother. The older I get, the more orphaned he will seem to me, and in some way more my son than my father. Returning here alone as a timid young workman of 19, he somehow became Charlie. His Hebrew name, which I loved for him, but which only my mother ever used, was Gedaliah. God is great. After the guardian of the Jews exempt from the Babylonian captivity who was treacherously murdered, say all the books, on a day of mourning that is still commemorated by fasting among the most pious Jews. Gedaliah became Charlie, and an unreachably lonely, self-centered, always peculiar man who was not like other Jewish fathers, not a hustler and a bustler. Not regular, not active for his children. In the midst of our tumultuous Jewish neighborhood, he was grimly alone. He became a great man for walking about instead of talking, for walking alone. He liked to feel himself near an exit, and he certainly knew how to make an exit quickly, silently, disapprovingly. He slid out the front door just as soon after supper as he could. I never suspected him of really going anywhere. He just wanted to get away from where he was currently at, to make his getaway. He was a man notably lacking in curiosity about other people and preferred to hug his solitude in lonely city walks and to sit out an afternoon in the Eastern Parkway branch of the Brooklyn Public Library. But as a boy, I idolized him for the connection with the America at large that he had made as a painter on the Union Pacific Railroad. He had gone west with the railroad, had been offered a homestead, had seen the great country that my illiterate housebound mother would never know. I lovingly enlarged every morsel of our walks to museum, parks, libraries. Our working class solidarity, father and son, as he described great labor struggles and the struggle for socialism. In my childhood, the only Jewish religion that could take him out of himself. I saw him break down when Eugene V. Debs died, when Robert M. La Follette lost the presidency, when Sacco and Vanzetti went to the chair. Later, when I began to write about him, I could feel the pulse of our every walk together in the Brooklyn Botanic Garden. As a Jew, segregated in the Pale, he would never have been allowed into St. Petersburg. "Nice," he allowed, "but you should have seen the Tsar's summer palace. What beautiful myths and obstinate delusions these despised Russian Jews lived on." My wonderful aunt, Nechama, for 70 years believed in the sainthood of Prince Peter Kropotkin. Russia would live by his teaching, then the whole world. But it was always bliss when my father returned from work with the New York World and the Jewish Daily Forward. "Forward, you have nothing to lose but your chains. You have a world to win." Standing with him at the kitchen sink, I kept pouring the harsh abrasive Gold Dust Twins washing powder into his hands as he gruntingly peels and scrubs the paint off. Sitting with him at Lewiston Stadium, waiting to hear our favorite late 19th century Russian heartthrobs, I am intoxicated by the blue, still light summer evening. Blaze. I would always have a sense of grace in the protracted summer light. Gold beaten out to ages. At 15, I felt such delight to be at an open-air concert with my father that I treasured his silences as part of the glittering lights on the stage, the long school shades drawn down in the city college across the street that I would be entering the next year, the slow vibration from side to side of all those emotional music lovers humming the slow movement of Tchaikovsky's Fifth along with the orchestra. Afterward, we ate watermelon in the Bickfords at 137th and Broadway, rode the open top of a Fifth Avenue bus. I was proud of my father then, and especially in those quiet, womanless weeks when my mother went off to Iowa to tend to a cousin who had gone off her head. My father and I, happily letting the household go to hell, ate in cafeterias. I took pleasure in every instance of our companionship, even in the never-to-be-gotten-over fact that when I was with him in the paint store, a lady had banteringly called him good-looking. We had proudly reported this to my mother, who seemed unimpressed. When I began to write about him, my memories of good times were slight, yet haunting. I seemed to have made him up from the beginning. He had been my first guide to the Russian past, to Gedaliah, the guardian of the Jews, exempt from the Babylonian captivity, the Jewish Workers' Bund of Russia and Poland, the Workmen's Circle, the Brotherhood of Painters and Decorators, the Wobblies he met out west, William Jennings Bryan, Big Bill Haywood, The Appeal to Reason, The New York Call, and always and above all, the sainthood of Eugene Victor Debs. While there is a lower class, I am in it. While there is a soul in prison, I am not free. I made my father up in the image of the dispossessed, the excluded, the oppressed working class, until neither of us was young anymore and Jews were no longer in the working class. Thinking about the mystery of my father's powerlessness, my unfatherly father's frequent references to the shock of his father's death and his long absence from his mother, I used to think of him as the orphan, something I certainly was not. I felt myself engulfed in my parents' marriage, trapped in their loneliness with each other, attached by destiny to mother, father, my baby sister, to the cousin who lived with us, and all her friends. I was attentive to every minute shade of feeling and temperament in everyone around me. The moodiness I called their Russianness was full of my commanding, endlessly resourceful work slave of a mother, my reclusive, ungiving father. I could not imagine a life in which they had no place. To be free of so much belonging. To have had, as my father said, no family. But he was an orphan, and I was not. He became a house painter, just moderately accomplished at this trade. And my sister and I became writers. When he read me on my childhood, it occurred to him that since both his children were writers, he would write something for publication about his childhood. His first and last effort was a few pages in a notebook, Trials and Tribulations of an Immigrant. When I typed it out for him, he wanted it sent to a magazine. I put in some periods, which he never did, and conventionalized the spelling. The original read as follows. After graduation from the Baron de Hirsch School of Agriculture in Minsk, I decided that Russia holds no future for me. The pogroms at the time made painful reading. I was dreaming about America, but how could I come to America when I did not have any money? So I decided to have a talk with the director of the school. He should give me a loan. I left Russia in April 1906. I arrived the following month at Ellis Island. The Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society took me off the boat. I had an address of an aunt. While eating supper, it was Friday evening at my table. There was a man sitting near me. I mention that I have an address of an aunt in New York. I showed him the address, and he told me that my aunt lives only one block away. At that time, quite a few men came to the Immigrant Aid Society for their meals, especially the Sabbath meals. The men that used to come for their meals were very poor. In the fall of 1906, there was an exciting campaign. William R. Hearst was running for governor on the Democratic ticket against Charles E. Hughes, who investigated the New York State insurance scandal. Mr. Hearst published even a Jewish newspaper to catch the Jewish votes on the East Side. Thousands of people used to congregate around the Jewish Daily Forward to hear the speakers. At that time, there was a Jewish committee who sent Jewish immigrants all over the country, especially to Texas. Instead, they sent me to Albany. They gave me a job in a potash factory near the Hudson River. I was working on a machine that covered the cans filled with potash in the fall of 1907. We went through a little depression, and the factory where I was working closed down, so I decided to go further west. I came to Chicago. I tried hard to get a job till somebody told me that I can get a job in the stockyards. You could smell of the stockyards for blocks away. I got a job in one of the packing houses to pick up the skins of cattle filled with salt and shake them free of salt. It was very hard work, and I quit after a week. I couldn't get another job, so I decided to go further west. I arrived in Omaha, Nebraska. I met a man that recommended me a job with the Union Pacific Railroad. They were painting a bridge in Omaha, and so I became a painter, although I did not know how to paint, but I have learned it. The bridge job lasted about 6 months. Then they sent me with a gang to paint stations and bridges on the road as far as Wyoming, till one day I was painting a roof on an ice house in Grand Island, Nebraska, a small village on the Union Pacific. The rope that held two ladders on both sides of the roof gave way, and I fell about 30 feet to the ground. But I was lucky there were telegraph wires near the ice house that broke my fall. Except for a few minor injuries, I was not badly hurt. An ambulance took me to a Catholic hospital in the village. The doctors and sisters were surprised that a Jew should work for a living. All the Jews they knew were businessmen or professionals. When I recovered, I went back to work. The men that worked with me were a bunch of Swedes and Norwegians. We used to get our pay once a month, and on payday, they used to get drunk, and for a couple of days they didn't work till they spent their money. After a while, I got tired of traveling, and I asked to be transferred to the Union Pacific shops in Omaha to paint boxcars. I remember one day Eugene V. Debs spoke in one of the largest parks. I was impressed by his eloquence, and an old man standing near me said that Mr. Debs reminds him of Abraham Lincoln, also a great orator. In the spring of 1910, I decided to go back to Chicago and to remain a painter. I got fired from a couple of jobs, but as I became more experienced, I could hold a job. And later, I joined the Union of the Brotherhood of Painters, and that was the best move I ever made. At that time in Chicago, there was Jane Addams Huell House in Chicago, where a whole lot of immigrants used to take English courses and American history. I also took some courses, but it was hard to work by the day and take lessons in the evening, and my education ended right there. I also used to attend lectures and debates on Sundays downtown. One of the most interesting debates used to take place between Clarence Darrow, the brilliant lawyer, and Arthur Morrow Lewis, the socialist, on religion and socialism. It was very interesting indeed. In 1912, I decided to go east, as I did not hear from my mother for 6 years. Communists made up an important part of the clientele in Room 315 during the 30s. But with each passing year, Stalin's purges, betrayals, and assassinations seemed to dishearten still another of those over-illuminated friends who had so often disapproved of my indiscriminate reading and had spent their afternoons in 315 doggedly relating Chaucer to dialectical materialism. My friend Hofstadter, passionately involved in the history of American intellect, had, like me, given up on Stalin and Stalinists from the moment we had learned of the GPU's executions of left dissidents in Spain, and had heard Earl Browder in Madison Square Garden proclaim, with his bureaucratic little smirk, that Trotsky, Bukharin, Zinoviev were Nazi agents, doctrinaires, unresting polemicists, ideologists of one idea, professional apologists for a horrible tyranny, and soon-to-be Hitler's apologists as well as Stalin's, when together Russia and Germany crushed Poland in 1939. Communists were obdurate fanatics with the mindset of secret policemen. But communists would always be around, first as communists, then as professional anti-communists. Hofstadter and I were in quest of, forever fascinated by, what Lewis Mumford had called the brown decades of the 19th century. The years of crude expansion and technical innovation in which our America had settled into shape. There was something about the end of the century, the explosive American money-making that would drive so many Americans mad, the piling up of new immigrant masses in the great American cities, the stark boldness and plainness of Brooklyn Bridge, the quivering truthfulness of Dickinson, the lonely realism of Eakins. That fascinated us. The background was America, the powerhouse, and our own fear of it. Hofstadter, the half-Jew and once Lutheran choir boy, liked to mock my fascination with Henry Adams by quoting Adams's insane hatred of Jews, especially immigrant Jews. God tried drowning out the world once, but it did no kind of good. And there are said to be 450,000 Jews now doing kosher in New York alone. God himself owned failure. But we were both in the spell of what had caught and frightened Adams. America, as even its most provincial visionaries had known, would soon be the greatest power instrument in history. We all went to make up that instrument. America was the perfect subject for history. It condensed so much into two centuries that here man was already in sight of his own end and fascinated by his capacity for self-destruction. This was a comfortable thought to the gloomily skeptical humorist in Hofstadter. He was a derisive critic and parodist of every American utopia and its wild prophets, a natural oppositionist to fashion and its satirist, a creature suspended between gloom and fun, between disdain for the expected and mad parody. He was filled with divided loyalties and powerfully disturbed emotions that never showed. The crazily promising yet undependable American scene gripped him absolutely. Like Mencken, he could not imagine a society more interesting. Mencken was a favorite resource in his many glooms. We had been formed by the Great Depression, but Hofstadter was a secret conservative in a radical period. The times caught up with him. He was secret in many things. In some strange no man's land between his Yiddish-speaking Polish father and his dead Lutheran mother. There were terrible fears for his life, even fiercer ambitions, that he seemed to hold together by the will to write, to succeed and to hold out, to dominate himself. I loved him. Even when he was dying of leukemia in 1970, he kept inching away at the first unfinished volume, America at 1750. Of the big narrative history that was his greatest dream as a writer. The manuscript was still at his bed when he died. I've never had the slightest trouble with my will. We met when we were 20. He had just married the brilliantly temperamental and sometimes overpowering Felice Suados. She had a graduate degree in philosophy, wanted to be a novelist, and had no sooner become another lowly woman researcher on time than she set out to write its medicine column. She came from a medical family. Dick was sitting in the single room on Montague Street in Brooklyn Heights that was their first New York apartment. And he looked marvelous, fresh. The all-American collegian just in from Buffalo with that unmistakable flat accent. He was talking with a crisp, laughing intelligence that refreshed me. And he was soon telling Jewish jokes, jokes about Jews by Jews, doing impersonations of Jews in the style of the raucous comedian Lou Holtz. Dick also specialized in playing our favorite non-hero, FDR, who was as despised on the left for not doing enough as he was hated on the right for doing all too much. We were obsessed by Roosevelt. He was so much the wily, slippery confidence man unable for very long to satisfy people of principle. But his real fault was that we did not know where his bantering, elusive sense of superiority came from. What had he done to deserve so much power? Dick, unlike other historians of our generation, was afraid of power, thought it naturally something that led to excess and made one heartless. Even when he became famous, he stiffly held off from all public leaders. Dick wanted to study power, not share in it. He meant to keep subtlety at any price. Roosevelt, the aristopolitician, forever mischievous, condescending, knew how to say "my old friend" in 11 languages. He reduced everything into one-sentence paragraphs and with this seductive simplicity was directly in touch with millions. Dick was directly afraid of power, including his wife's power over him. Felice was probably the first to recognize just how brilliant he was and fought him on it. I understood her driving rages, was all too familiar with her energy, her ambition, the unappeasable frustration that poured out its wrath on her husband's head, more vivid to me than anyone else in that driven herd of Jews arriving at the pierhead, was the figure of a young woman standing with her back to me in Alfred Stieglitz's great photograph of 1907, The Steerage. I dimly knew that Stieglitz had taken the photograph going to Europe. The figures in the photograph were returning, but no matter. The woman is wearing a long wide skirt, and she draped herself head and back with a long white towel with a double striped border that puts her at the center of the picture. Though she is surrounded on every side, the others are looking down or just away in mid-ocean reverie. Nobody is looking at her. This surprises me very much. I cannot take my eyes off her, and I cannot understand why so many men wearing derbies, caps, one is even in a straw hat, can be so dreamily looking down without being as fixed by her as I am. She is my mother. In that picture, and for that year, she had better not turn around and let me see her face. The woman I know, have I ever known another so well, is bent to the service of some undecipherable tyranny. I can more easily picture her, even before her marriage, as distinctly unbeautiful, obsessive, madly anxious, undefeatably active. She is obsessed with her failure to change anything. In none of her photographs does she ever smile. There is a certain suspicion. Even when she allows herself a nap, the Yiddish phrase is to catch a little dream. She complains of never being able to dream at all. Illiterate and a nervous stammerer, she is nevertheless as resourceful and intuitive as the world was before it learned to read. But she will never accomplish anything except us. She will never know when to stop. She will never lose some abysmal loneliness in the new world. She will never be happy or make her husband happy. Yet with pride, I picture her at 18, not afraid to set out. She is the ugly duckling in a family of just too many girls. She arrives with a beloved, handsome older brother who will unwillingly return on the pleas of a wife too pious and fearful to cross the heathen ocean, a wife too pious to flee the Nazis, and who will be shot by them right on her doorstep. My mother at 18 wears a pince-nez, a long black skirt, a severe black shirtwaist, and every day except the Sabbath, goes back and forth between her room on Orchard Street and the Triangle Shirtwaist Factory. If you don't come in on Sunday, don't come in on Monday. One day, her left hand is caught in the sewing machine. A needle goes straight down the palm, severing a large vein. They sew it up for her so clumsily that a tuft of flesh always lies folded over the palm. But though she is already bent over the machine, as she will be for life, she knows beyond anything else that we exist in this world in order to be married. A Jewish girl unmarried is alone in the world, a condition horrid, unnatural, a little deaf. In from the West comes my father, who hasn't heard from his mother in 6 years. In comes my mother, whose beloved, handsome older brother has returned to comfort his pious, fearful wife. My father and mother meet in an East Side boarding house. They are from neighboring provinces in Russia. They marry. On the Saturday night they marry, knowing hardly anyone, my mother goes out and brings back some food to their room and finds my father sobbing. The Hofstadters. Felice, openly laughing, would listen with rapture to my tales of an anarchist uncle and aunt who had 5 sons but disdained bourgeois marriage, yet separated because my aunt had been reading Marx. Of the baker widow in our tenement who invariably left a great round onion roll for me to find when I left for school in the morning. In Buffalo, Jews who had made it into the middle class called themselves white, and poor Jewish workers black. My family was definitely black. Felice would grin at me as she read aloud letters she was writing her old friends in Northampton and Cambridge about me and my pent-up mother. Like her political passion for sailors and other proletarian types in Brooklyn Heights, who are always hilariously crawling in through the window to take potluck with the Hofstadters, this was what she liked to call her Marxist directness. With the many medical men in her family, she fancied herself a doctor of society, a doctor of souls, torn by the free enterprise system. She explained her friends to themselves as easily as she explained the bankruptcy of philosophy under capitalist culture. Felice's hearty sense of her own powers tended to put Dick into shadow. He was certainly not to emerge as a historian until he had doggedly looked after her in her sudden, shocking, fatal illness at the end of the war. He began to write the American political tradition on a pad in her darkened sick room. He could not see the first words, but he finished the book. I, on my side, also felt endlessly challenged by Felice. She was on time. She was in the great world and knew it. What authority she radiated over us, what clinical powers. She was large, assured, eager, scathing yet flirtatious. An elusive minx under the baby bangs that rustled on her forehead while she patiently explained the laws of social development underlying famous novels and systems of philosophy. She made me long for so much daily excitement from a woman in my own life. She would have been shocked if I had told her. Not her ideas impressed me, not even her bountiful and coy figure. It was her pride, her belief in mastery. The young woman who in 1942 is also 27, to whom I have been married for 4 years, and who now walks into room 315 to pick me up for dinner before we both return to work, is dark, looks as Russian as her name, is slight, intensely gentle and reserved, and very good to look at. Natasha, my wife, has olive skin, a heart-shaped face that regularly tears me to bits, is loving yet removed. In my obsession to possess her all the way, I am regularly defeated. I will keep looking for her long after we have parted. She is a girl of precise, delicate movements at the microscope. Perhaps her heart is hidden from herself as well as from me. She has a crazy mother from whom her father is always in flight, and a brilliant young brother who will die of his mother's insatiable bitterness. She is very careful not to show too much. The day after our wedding, I joyously came home to find her on the floor, almost unconscious after a swooping visit from her mother. In this surpassing silence of the heart, we live like two friends, always sympathiche, spiritually close. In these first years, she has made everything possible for me. I've never felt so easy, so loving, so sure of my work. Natasha's long black hair is coiled in a Russian woman doctor's bun at the very top of her head, to leave her face free for science. This leaves her neck free and glistening. I can never get enough of the back of Natasha's neck. At Bellevue, in her white lab coat, she wears delicate little glasses as she bends over the microscope studying influenza strains for her thesis. She makes such a tenderly appealing figure that I drop the Princess Casamassima to rush across the dusty lab and hug her. The white mice, alarmed by my unscientific attitude, race round and round their cages. Natasha wears the brown stockings worn by all progressive girls in the 30s. We boycott the silk produced by imperialist Japan and walks slightly pigeon-toed. There is a schoolgirl's hesitation and modesty in her walk, especially when she clutches her briefcase tightly, but somewhat timidly. We work all the time. Sundays alone, we take off. Before Pearl Harbor, we take excursion steamers up and down the coast to the Atlantic Highlands and to Point Judith in Rhode Island. We tramp the bridges that in those days always had a lane for walkers. On Brooklyn Bridge, it was the Central Promenade. And one birthday walk all around Manhattan Island, Sunday morning, the BMT subway station at Whitehall is empty and echoes silence along its blue and white tiles as we wait for a train that may never come. The vacancy of the BMT this crazy Sunday morning makes me cringe. Why am I emptily pursuing New York Sunday after Sunday? Natasha grimly trotting after me like a good Chinese wife. What am I looking for in all this mad prowling? Walking is thinking, thinking is moving, moving out. Natasha is stuck with this dynamo, as she wonderingly puts it, who stammeringly cannot stop reading, noting, collecting material, walking, writing, pushing at the world to let him in. Natasha makes all things possible. The first happy years are consumed by work, my work. I live in a romantic cloud, never admitting that anything is ever wrong, that I can ever want anything else. Natasha and I love each other. We'll go on loving for years after our marriage has collapsed. We were the last Puritans. Any bluntness between husbands and wives was unknown to me. Failure? nothingness, losing, had so long been the background of my life, of everyone related to me, that Natasha's growing uneasiness about her work at Bellevue made me cringe. There, suddenly, unbelievably, seemed no way of bridging a gap. What are we doing Sunday after Sunday, homelessly tramping about? What are we doing in the New Jersey hills this Sunday, of all Sundays, when we hear from a passing car radio that Costa Rica has just declared war on Japan? Costa Rica? We did not learn of Pearl Harbor till we had returned in the evening, then rushed to Times Square to buy the first papers, to watch the crowds, to stare at the shocking news bulletins racing around the Times Tower. It was frozen cold that December night. A few mildly drunk sailors were trying to whoop it up, but the crowd was silent, numb, waiting. The next day, a liberated Roosevelt went before Congress, asked for a declaration of war. Would I get to finish my book? Planes were overhead patrolling the coastline. At 3 p.m, New York had its first air raid alarm. On Fifth Avenue, an ambulance happened at the same time to be screaming its way through traffic. People rushed out of offices and the library to see New York under fire. I would be allowed to finish my book. It was published. I was invited to join the New Republic. We moved to Lexington in 24th. And soon, everything was as different as the view from our casement windows. We were in the heart of the city, and the battle had just begun. Working on my history of modern American writing, I had not known many writers. I had reviewed many books, but did not think of myself as a challenge to other writers. When my book, my first great deed, opened up so many things for me, I was amazed at suddenly coming out well. I felt like a man afraid of heights who finds himself looking over the side of a roof. As the reviews began to come in, the sudden invitations, the florid compliments and passionate attacks, I would take any train to Washington to lose myself in the commotion of war. I was desperate to get overseas. I could not bear so much examination, the loss of my own solitude, when I had had the whole long day to read and write in. Above all, I could not bear having to justify myself to the many writers around the New Republic who seemed even more amazed by my book than I was. But more often I would find myself following women down the street, excited by the whirl of New York and Midtown, the smell of wartime money, the high lean tower of the RCA building, the flashing reflections of St. Patrick's in the glass doors of department stores across the way. I was excited by the women in the bus every morning, the women in the morning light, the proud, the fashionable women of Midtown, the breasts and hot purple mouths of the women in Saks, the blazing femaleness in those department store windows on the street and at every counter. Women, hot and cold, looking at once, so that I longed for them from my office window and dreamed about them all night. I now dreamed continually of women I had seen in Midtown and had followed. I was strict as ever and ashamed, but not so ashamed that I did not go on dreaming and waiting. In 1942, the New Republic was still published in New York, but even in its glossy offices, in the building high over Hattie Carnegie's at 49th and Madison, it bore little resemblance to the Journal of Opinion that, from the original brownstone, far off on West 21st Street, near the docks, had been such an intellectual force in American life. Although many famous names were still on the masthead, the magazine was entirely in the hands of Bruce Bliven, who put it out with the help of Betty Hewling, the loud, swearing, fiercely competent copy editor, and two young men. The other young man was Thomas Sancton, a sensitive newspaper man from New Orleans who was awed and horrified by New York. After passionate editorials on the outrages being committed against black soldiers in the Deep South, he published even more bitterly felt laments on the inhumanity of the terrible big city. Between Malcolm Cowley, the last literary editor with independent authority, and myself, Bliven hired me because he had never heard of me. He was always under attack from literary intellectuals. There had been a whole succession of angrily frustrated editors of the book section. My immediate predecessor was Nigel Dennis, who had quit after a more than usually violent disagreement with the boss. As I did not know in 1942, Edmund Wilson had been fired years before by the owner, the daughter of the millionaire William C. Whitney, and the widow of Willard Strait, after an unsuccessful effort to oust Bliven. "I'm a terrible conspirator," Wilson confessed unnecessarily when he told me the story at Wellfleet on Cape Cod in 1960. Before the farcical in-office putsch, there had been a bitter dispute after the command had gone out from the owner, now married to an Englishman and living in England, to reverse its between-wars isolationism and to support the war. The first editors of the New Republic, founded in 1914 on the last wave of the progressive movement, had identified so enthusiastically with Woodrow Wilson that they never recovered from Versailles and grimly held to the isolationism then usual with American progressives. Edmund Wilson saw Pearl Harbor as a plot by Roosevelt. The old New Republic editors were now being asked to support the war, but Wilson seemed to see this more as a war against Bruce Bliven than against Hitler. Many of the original editors were persuaded to leave their names on the masthead, but to stay away, except for an occasional office lunch. The magazine was left entirely to Bliven, who dominated but showed no joy. He felt inferior to the New Republic tradition. Bliven had been managing editor of a New York daily before he had been hired by Herbert Crowley in the 20s to lend his practical talents to a magazine famous for intellectual stars like Walter Lippmann and Edmund Wilson. By 1942, his long war with the old New Republic intellectuals had left a personal bitterness that could be heard at every office lunch. Bliven was a stout, round man who looked to me very much like the Oliver Hardy of Laurel and Hardy. Like Oliver Hardy, he assumed an anxious geniality that often collapsed into bitter self-control. The literary side of the magazine worried him, because certain damned intellectuals had put things over on him. He brooded on the memory of Edmund Wilson, his great enemy on the old staff. No one told me why Wilson had left. His name could be mentioned only if Bliven brought it up. I did not know this. What do I think of Edmund Wilson? I think, damn it to hell, that Edmund Wilson is the best critic in the English-speaking world. Bliven was suspicious of literary men who mocked the war-swollen American ego. Alan Tate, stung by my criticisms of his self-proclaimed reactionary criticism, challenged me to publish more sonnets at Christmas. Tate, not yet a Catholic, had in the 30s written two dense and imploring sonnets at Christmas, lamenting his physical oddity, dull critter of enormous head, and his anguish, punished by crimes of which I would be quit, over a stinking lie he had told at 10 that got a black boy whipped. More sonnets at Christmas showed Tate no longer wailing a dead Christ, but well on the way to accepting his resurrection. More resolute than he had been 10 years earlier, he strikes out against the pride of war and the delusions of total victory. the Huns gelded and feeding in a ring, and the liberal delusion that the current war would ease the path to social progress. Henry Wallace, who was to become editor of the New Republic after FDR, yanked him from the vice presidency, had, in his confident dreaminess, explained that the century on which we are entering can be and must be the century of the common man. One of Wallace's rumored war aims was a quart of milk to every Hottentot. Tate scorned well-milked Chinese, Negroes who cannot sing. He intimated a definite contempt. The American people, fully armed with assurance policies, righteous and harmed, battle the world of which they're not at all. Deriding his past weakness, Tate now saw the boy who at 10 had told the stinking lie that got a black boy whipped as growing into a typical American youth untouched by guilt, asleep to his spiritual nothingness, whose only fear is of an enemy in remote oceans, unstalked by Christ. These are the better notions. Tate's lines were more difficult in structure than in meaning. They were often simply evasive, as if to hide his ill-concealed longing for absolutism. His poetry had a way of saying things in opposition to an unseen critic. Like Tate himself, they seemed to say and unsay things in the same breath. The cool, clear authority behind his critical essays became, in his poems, a form of public agony. He was obsessed by Eliot, but he could never seem to attain Eliot's honestly suffering tone. There was something unacknowledged and unexpressed in Tate's poetry. But Tate was famous for thinking the whole modern world an infamy. His new Christmas sonnets said that the New World War was just another power play. The war had nothing but more evil to contribute to the secret grief at the heart of modern life. All things were in a state of contradiction. All wars were boyish and fought by boys. But some of these boys, in our new Roman Empire, were proconsuls of the air. Since the New Republic was running on its cover, "Beware a Static War," Bliven was not likely to enjoy Tate's barbed offering to us of more sonnets at Christmas. He would not publish them. "If I do not understand these poems," he summed up one late wintry afternoon, after a hopeless argument into which I had dragged Malcolm Cowley for support, "how in hell do you expect our readers to understand them?" This picture of our audience surprised me. I insisted on a free hand in the literary department, and Tate's sonnets were published, but there was no understanding between the front of the book and the back of the book. The major purpose of the time, as one New Republic cover put it, was to turn the war into a global New Deal. Since Roosevelt had happily substituted Dr. Win the War for Dr. New Deal, this was the kind of self-hypnosis that was soon to put Henry Wallace into the editor's chair. The century of the common man was just a starter. Wallace liked to call Christ the greatest liberal of all when he put life before things, when he said to seek the kingdom of heaven first and things would take care of themselves. The front of the book was politics, the war, the real world. The back of the book was literature, the arts, a lot of intellectuals. The contrast between Bliven's anxieties and his loudly crusading editorials for a global New Deal soon made the New Republic futile to me. Furtive whisperings and impolite laughter could be heard from cubicle to cubicle. In mine, I saw a procession of young village poets and philosophers: Delmore Schwartz, William Barrett, Isaac Rosenfeld, Weldon Keyes, for whom the only real magazine was Partisan Review. They looked on the NR as a source of cash, but despised it with all the righteous fury that we were likely to feel for a magazine that seemed to think of the Soviet-American alliance as a progressive war, a people's war, a lovable war. Stalin was now everyone's Uncle Joe. He was not ours. since the managing editor from New Orleans wrote against New York intellectuals, and Bliven expected their scorn, the magazine, famous for bringing together Randolph Bourne, Walter Lippmann, Herbert Crowley, Edmund Wilson, Francis Hackett, Robert Morse Lovett, Philip Littell, and Malcolm Cowley, was clearly different from what it had been. It was still printed on the crumbly butcher paper that seemed indispensable to minority causes in the United States. But it never had more, it often had less, than 30,000 subscribers. These were the faithful behind the New Republic and the Nation. Bliven's anxious leadership reflected the end of a period. There was no illumination in the front of the book, and no hope in the back of the book. There were explosive days when Delmore Schwartz happened in and out of the elevator. Delmore never just came in. He spilled out in a reedy voice, a headlong rush of words that seemed to engage every muscle in his face as he twisted and spat in the rage of his opinions. On the days when Delmore erupted into the office to get a book for review and to berate me for something I had just published, he conversed in a style of great bitterness that nevertheless tried to be classical and impersonal in its reasoning. Since he could write without rage, and always with a great show of reasoning, a certain classical outlook, he had been trained in philosophy, was the style of his terribly proper intellectual poems and profound early stories. The contrast was even physical. He moved heavily, his head turning with some uneasiness. He seemed to see his life as a clash between gravity, heaviness, depression, and poetry, which was the absolute, the truth, elusive as the lip of snow on the windowsill. I would look at his amazingly wide, stone-white, sweaty brow, knotted with intellectual indignation as with ropes. I would grow properly frightened. Delmore was such a prophecy of the last literary generation to believe in the authority of culture, the logic of tradition. There was this belief, which not even Hitler would destroy in some of us, that there was a reason behind all frightfulness. Of course, every political season the reason changed. Once it was imperialism. When the killing began, it was human nature, or the devil in us. Delmore was already the poet on the cross of culture, every muscle contorted, Brooklyn's best nailed down. But from his cross he shrieked the most brilliant things, the most scathing things, excitedly analyzing a passage by my king, James Joyce, and like a mad shuttlecock, flying at anyone who saw less beauty in his favorite texts than he did. Delmore talked with his whole face. The hopeless intensity of every feeling was there the last time I saw him. It was a few years before his terrible death in 1966 in a sleazy Broadway hotel, after which his body lay around Bellevue unknown and unclaimed. He was railing against his friend, Saul Bellow. Bellow was returning the fund he had collected for Delmore's treatment. Delmore did not think he needed treatment. He thought of the fund as his personal property. He was in a squalid box of a room on Greenwich Street near the river. It was a room that only long practice in disaster could have discovered. He was buried up to his fine eyes in accusations of betrayal, unbearably sicker than in the 40s. Not so much talking as accusing, erupting, plotting, demanding, suffering. Everything was vehement and tragic. And once. You cannot leave him without hating yourself. His face could be marvelous even in his most manic flights. It had a way of withdrawing into lonely thought that somehow transcended every angry occasion. His body nobly represented him even when he was throwing words at people he did not trust. Although he was bitterly witty in his mysterious fashion. Europe is still the biggest thing in North America. Storming up against people with the same passionate logic with which he argued for or against certain books, his face was as remarkable in a relaxed moment as the first time I had seen him, in a train going up to Boston. I'd been struck by the immense intellectual devotion in it, the fine distraction, the obstinate love behind the familiarly Jewish frantic manner. In those first days, he looked what he was, obsessive, unable to let go on anyone or about anything, but more gifted than anyone else, not petty, full of the excited discoveries he was then making as a teacher of composition at Harvard. He looked, as a friend said, our poet. No writer of my generation, typically lamented by a communist poet as caught between the wars with all the streetlights out, knew so well from the inside what literature was and what a poet should aim at. He looked proud. He still had a young authority. He had come on the scene in his early 20s with stories and poems that astonished everyone by being impeccably formally right in the prevailing Eliot tradition. Emotional ingenuity tuned to perfect pitch by gravity of manner. Although he talked fast and masticated his words, he could grow marvelously possessed between gulps of argument and boyish smiles. There was the unmistakable look of the poet speaking from his own depths. He stood for something, and he knew it. The single most beautiful thing he was ever to write, the classic story of the Jewish son unable to escape the history represented by his family, was the highly charged personal fantasy In Dreams Begin Responsibilities. The narrator imagines himself in the darkness of a movie theater, watching his father walk down the quiet, shaded streets of Brooklyn to court his mother. The light is bad, the film is patchy, and from time to time the young writer watching his own unhappy destiny being prepared in the bad temper of his father and the quarrels of his parents-to-be cries out from the darkness of the theater against the ill-fated marriage. At one point, he stands up and tells the figures on the screen not to marry. Don't do it. It's not too late to change your minds, both of you. Nothing good will come of it, only remorse, hatred, scandal, and two children whose characters are monstrous. In Dreams Begin Responsibilities was straight, beautiful, haunting. It was a little masterpiece that used up a man's whole life even before he had lived it. It was the greatest fable I was ever to read of our experience. It was the one work of Delmore Schwartz's life that had the power of a dream, and it remains with me as if I had dreamed it myself. Delmore was never again to bring out with such precision what it was to be a marked man, under a curse and wolfishly alone. We used to laugh at the story that Delmore's mother had appropriated his name from a delicatessen. Though Delmore was not more innocently pretentious than Lionel, Clifton, Clifford, Hilton, Leslie, Walt Whitman, but with his terrible belief in working things out intellectually, Delmore saw in his mother's innocent cultural pretension a wound like circumcision. He would be a clown with an urgent message to deliver. Delmore's tortured personal epics, Shenandoah and Genesis, showed him struggling with ridiculous names for himself like Shenandoah Fish and Hershey Green. The friends he put into his stories were also cruelly tagged by fate. Poor Shenandoah, poor Hershey, poor Rudyard Bell, Edmund Kish, Ferdinand Harrap, Francis French, and Mortimer London, poor Algernon, poor von Humboldt Fleischer, a final sacrifice to his famous self-laceration. Such names, piled on each other, became funnier than Groucho's J. Worthington Silverstein. Delmore could not laugh anything off. He practiced irony as if this famous literary strategy of the time was a Jew's only defense. Of course, he could not see the joke. He was the drama. A poet shouldn't be that unhappy, Auden said with derision, looking at the photograph on Delmore's book, Summer Knowledge. The eyes looked almost blind in their sick, milky introspection. The face that had once moved me by its independent devotion was now furrowed and creased with unimaginable pain. Less than ever now was he looking at anything, but anyone who understood Delmore's mind knew that he was finally drowning in his own blood. He was hopelessly caught up in the logical web, still trying to prove the injustice that was everywhere being practiced against him. This was his lifelong dilemma. The worse things got, the more actively, frantically, outrageously he argued against them. He was a terrifying and terrified rationalist, a prisoner of his superb intellectual training. The great philosophers and poets were always in his mind, training him into a victim of the logic he loved more than himself. He would never come to believe in the absurd that filled the decade in which he died. His end was absurd enough to please the exuberant chaos around him, but it was absurd in Delmore's own desperate style. He had surely predicted it. He was, more than the rest of us, expert in anguish. Even when impaled on his favorite theme, betrayal, he lacked the saving grace of madness. He was the prisoner of culture and could never be distracted from its supposed truth. He would never lose himself in that dream of a totally other world that becomes to the eye of genius the only real world. Delmore could be maddening, but he never relaxed into the full madness of art. He would never lose his faith in the rationality of the world. 1943. Now began the nightmare that would bring everything else into question, that will haunt me to my last breath. The Nazis had organized the killing of every Jew within their grasp. 3 months before Pearl Harbor, Charles Lindbergh, at an America First rally, had threatened the Jewish race. Instead of agitating for war, the Jewish groups in this country should be opposing it in every possible way, for they will be among the first to feel its consequences. Even Edmund Wilson, another isolationist, was to write in later years that while Jews had even stronger reasons for fighting Hitler than had their ancestors for resisting the Greeks and the Romans, this was illogical since the extermination of 6 million Jews was already very far advanced by the time the United States took action. By taking action, Wilson meant Pearl Harbor, which he attributed to a conspiracy by Roosevelt. The systematic murder of Europe's Jews had not yet begun by the time we entered the war, but by the end of 1942, and especially the terrible spring of 1943, when the Warsaw Ghetto was destroyed, after its last desperate attack on the Nazis, it was clear to me what was not clear to progressives, with their whimpers for a global New Deal. The Nazis planned what even Edmund Wilson called the extermination of every Jew on earth. But to everyone but us, and by no means all of us, this was unreal. In the second battle for Kharkov, the Germans were reported to have given up a tactical advantage in order to round up Jews. Meanwhile, Hitler's recent ally Stalin destroyed every Democrat and socialist who could oppose his Poland after the war. Heinrich Ehrlich and Viktor Alter, leaders of the Jewish Workers' Bund of Poland, had fled to Russia and gladly joined the Anti-Fascist People's Committee organized by the Russians after the Germans attacked them in 1941. Ehrlich and Alter were arrested and shot, charged with urging Soviet troops not to resist the Nazis and urging an immediate peace treaty with Nazi Germany. Even in death, the Jews were an anomaly, a contradiction to the great unifying tendencies of modern life and revolution. Though prime objects of Hitler's hatred, they were a side issue for everyone else. There had never been any real room for them in the secular thought of the Enlightenment. There was no room for them in communist images of a final conflict that would resolve all the divisions of humanity by obliterating the class enemy. There was especially no room for them on an earth dominated by the revolutionary zeal of the Nazis. by the overwhelming logic of totalitarianism, all things and all people not absorbable into the sacred movement would have to be destroyed. By the overwhelming movement toward total domination that the Nazis had set up in Germany and now all over Europe under the slogan of revolution, an organic revolution that assimilated into the new order all existing institutions. The Jews could not be included. They had to die. The Jews, anywhere, had to die. They were the enemy. They were unassimilable. The Jews had been ruled out of existence by the Nazis and could not be admitted into the thought of those who were fighting Hitler. In a world increasingly conceived as the struggle of modern revolutionary forces, the Jews seem to be entirely a people of the past, living in the past. Revolutions exist in order to perpetuate revolution. The Jews could not be fitted into Nazi or communist schemes. They did not belong. They could not be explained. So now their organized destruction could not be accounted for. The indifference of the Vatican extended even to the priests and nuns who had been born Jews. The Allies would not bomb the railroad tracks leading to Auschwitz, support Jewish self-defense behind Nazi lines, open their doors to the masses of refugees. Roosevelt could not pay attention to the Jewish problem. He could not take it all in. Churchill did, and was afraid of disturbing American opinion. The Jews were not a factor in Allied plans for the post-war scene. The Jews were just a people accused, as of old, a people whose only mission was to feel guilty, without any suspension, any possibility of salvation, even through conversion. A whole people in the control of the most powerful state in Europe was condemned by the infamy that it had been guilty throughout history and should in its totality be made a sacrifice. Jews were supposed to bear witness, to give meaning to their historic existence as Jews, to lift the curse from the word Jew and turn it into a blessing. Some who were not living the atrocity now sought to live it, to live the passion being suffered by their brothers and sisters. A tremor went through those not yet lined up for extermination. I did not know then how many Jews were scratching with their fingernails the low ceilings of the gas chambers into which they had been herded, family by family, hand in hand with their children. I did not know then that the dead by families would, the morning after, be standing together in death so tightly wedged together that the capos would have to break them apart with hooks. But I did know that there were Jews outside the circle of death who felt that they could speak out, that Jews could not be totally pushed to the sidelines in death as they had been in life. On May 12, 1943, in London, the Polish Jew, Shmuel Ziegelboim, who represented the Jewish Workers' Bund in the Polish cabinet in exile, was found dead by his own hand in a London flat. His wife and child had been killed by the Nazis. I had never heard of Shmuel Ziegelboim. And so many socialists, Jews, and Poles had already died that I might never have thought of him if he had not left a letter that was published in a negligible corner of the New York Times. His letter was addressed to the President of Poland and to Prime Minister Sikorski. I take the liberty of addressing to you my last words, and through you to the Polish government and to the Polish people, the governments and peoples of the Allied states, to the conscience of the world. From the latest information received from Poland, it is evident that the Germans, with the most ruthless cruelty, are now murdering the few remaining Jews in Poland. Behind the ghetto's walls, the last act of a tragedy unprecedented in history is being performed. The responsibility for this crime of murdering the entire Jewish population of Poland falls in the first instance on the perpetrators, but indirectly it is also a burden on the whole of humanity. the people and the governments of the Allied States, which thus far have made no effort toward concrete action for the purpose of curtailing this crime. By the passive observation of the murder of defenseless millions and of the maltreatment of children, women, and old men, these countries have become the criminals' accomplices. I must also state that although the Polish government has in a high degree contributed to the enlistment of world opinion, it has yet done so insufficiently. It has not done anything that could correspond to the magnitude of the drama being enacted now in Poland. From some 3,500,000 Polish Jews and about 700,000 other Jews deported to Poland from other countries, according to official statistics provided by the Underground Bund Organization, there remained in April of this year only about 300,000. And this remaining murder still goes on. I cannot be silent. I cannot live. While remnants of the Jewish people of Poland, of whom I am a representative, are perishing, my comrades in the Warsaw Ghetto took weapons in their hands on that last heroic impulse. It was not my destiny to die there together with them, but I belonged to them. And in their mass grave.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.